for Chesterfield.
Howdy, folks, a big hello. We're here to start the Crosby Show. Before you do another thing, just take this tip from Brother Bing.
Sound off
for Chesterfield.
Sound off
for Chesterfield.
Try a pack of Chesterfields and do it
today.
Someone waits for me.
This is Ken Carpenter. Welcome you to the Bing Crosby Show for Chesterfield, produced and transcribed in Hollywood, with John Scott Trotter and his orchestra, Judd Collins and the Bears, and Bing's guests, Miss Patti Page and Mr. Bob Burns. Ladies and gentlemen, this being National Potato Chip Week, I would like to announce that the National Potato Chip Institute has designated Gary Crosby as this year's Chip Off the Old Block. And now, here's the old block himself, Bing Crosby.
That's right, Ken. Gary did get the gold potato chip. Suitably inscribed, too, yes. And thanks to our friends in Idaho and Maine and wherever Spud Sprout for this crisp, appetizing award.
Gee, you know, I'll bet Bob Hope is burned up that you Crosbys were so honored.
No, he's been taken care of, Ken. It so happens that the potato chip people have honored Hope, too.
Oh, really?
Yes.
What award did he get?
He's been selected as Mr. Deep Fat of 1952.
That boiled sizzle at the... You know, Bing, perhaps we shouldn't kid Bob.
Why not?
Though.
He kids.
Well, I understand. I think we should be careful.
Why?
I understand Bob contracted a very severe case of poison oak.
I'd like to see the oak that could poison him.
No, he really did get poison oak. Got it playing golf.
Well, he always wanted to be a scratch player. Now he can really scratch. Say, I suppose I could do the handsome thing, though.
What's that?
Well, you know, send him a bottle of calamine lotion and one of those wooden hands on a stick to reach those far away places. He's got an abundance of them.
Down yonder.
Yes, down yonder.
You know, Bing, I've often wondered, what kind of a golfer is Bob? What's his handicap?
His lack of talent, I guess. But let's forget old Clabbergal for the nonce, shall we, Ken, and consider this potato chip business. This is a very engrossing subject.
I'd like to hear about it.
Because the Institute has sent me some literature on the subject, and I was surprised to find that the history of the potato chip is alive, just teeming with drama.
Well, sounds exciting.
Educational, too. For instance, did you know that the first potato chip was made in 1853?
1853, yes, huh? You know, I think I got that one at the Villanova the other night.
Well, now, you should be happy. That was a vintage year, you know.
Good.
Yeah. But the whole thing really came about accidentally. Mm-hmm. See, the potato chip was invented when an old Indian lady... She dropped a thin slice of potato into a frying pan.
I hope I get that question on a quiz program sometime.
Well, if you do, you'll be in the chips. Yeah. Anyhow, there was a fella... When she dropped this thing in the frying pan, a fellow named George Crumb came by. He saw the crisp bit of potato in the pan, and he popped it into his mouth.
And what did he say?
Holy smoke, that's hot.
That's what he said, huh?
That's a direct quote. Those words are on microfilm in the time capsule.
Just think, if that fella hadn't eaten that hunk of potato, the potato chip would never have been.
Oh, don't even talk of such a thing, Ken. What a frustrating thought that could be. You know, if it wasn't for the potato chip, Elsa Maxwell might never have invented the cocktail party.
Yeah. Well, Bing, since you've done some research on this subject...
Yes, I have.
Maybe you can help me out with something that's, it's bothered me for some time.
I'd be happy to.
You know, after eating potato chips at a party, what's the proper method of getting the salt off your fingers?
Well, there are several accepted methods, Ken. One way is to pet a dog if one is handy.
Probably a shaggy one, I presume.
I believe Emily Post recommends a French poodle. They're good. Another way, of course, is to casually rub your hands over the drapes. But I guess, after all, the best method is to find a friend who's wearing a blue serge suit and slap him on the back.
Is that really the best way?
Well, that way you can see if you're getting any results.
Positively ingenious.
Well, the Americans are forever inventive. Now, Ken, I think we'd better get on to some music here now. We've yacked quite a while. Our opening selection is a little wintry roundelay, suitable for the season, entitled Sleigh Ride. John Scott, jingle them bells.
Mm-hmm.
Just hear those sleigh bells jingling, ring ting a tingling too. Come on, it's lovely weather for a sleigh ride together with you. Outside, the snow is falling and friends are calling you. Come on, it's lovely weather for a sleigh ride together with you. Giddy-up, 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 let's go. Let's look at the show. We're riding in a wonderland of snow. Giddy-up, 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 it's grand. Just holding your hand.
We're gliding along with a song of a merry fairyland.
Our cheeks are nice and rosy and comfy cozy are we. We're snuggled up together like two birds of a feather wouldn't be.
Let's take that road before us and sing up a chorus or two.
Come on, it's lovely weather for a sleigh ride together with you.
There's a birthday party at the home of Farmer Gray. It'll be the perfect ending of a perfect day. We'll be singing the songs we love to sing without a single stop.
At the fireplace where we watch the chestnuts pop,
pop, pop, pop.
There's a happy feeling nothing in the world can buy. When they pass around the jelly and the pumpkin pie, aye, aye.
It'll nearly be like a picture print by Courier and Ives. These wonderful things are the things we remember all through our lives.
Just hear those sleigh bells jingling, ring-ting-a-tingling too. Come on, it's lovely weather for a sleigh ride together with you.
Let's take that road before us and sing up a chorus or two.
Come on, it's lovely weather for a sleigh ride together with you.
Whoa now, whoa there, easy.
Steady there,
steady. Everybody out.
Ding, ding, ding.
Now, I've got a word for all the folks in the more than 1,250 towns where our show is heard. Soon now, you'll hear me telling you about Chesterfield's sales increasing in your hometown, just as they're increasing fast in Providence, Milwaukee, in my hometown of Peoria, Illinois, and all over the country. Now, there are two reasons for this. Chesterfields are much milder, and they give you the added protection of no unpleasant aftertaste. No unpleasant aftertaste, confirmed by a leading research organization. Mildness? Well, you can prove that by smoking Chesterfields. So sound off for Chesterfield. For the first time, you'll get the cigarette that's much milder with the added protection of no unpleasant aftertaste. Try a pack of Chesterfields and do it today.
This boy is absolutely right, friends. Now, folks, I would like to present our first guest of the evening, a young lady who is easily the country's top female recording artist. From Claremore, Oklahoma, the singing rage, Miss Patti Page.
Thank you, Bing, and hello, everyone.
What are you going to kick off with tonight, Patti? What are you going to open up with?
Well, I'd like to do a new song called Come What May.
This happened to be a recent recording?
Well, we did it about 2 weeks ago, Bing.
Well, we're getting right in on the ground floor, folks. This is practically a premiere performance of Come What May. John, are you ready?
A gypsy with a crystal ball to gaze in can look into the future, so they say. But I am so afraid of fortune tellers. To know the truth might cast my world away. Just suppose I called upon a gypsy to find you're gonna break my heart someday. So, darling, I'm confessing, not knowing is a blessing. You can keep me guessing, come what may. A gypsy with a crystal ball to gaze in can look into the future, so they say. But I am so afraid of fortune tellers. To know the truth might cast my world away. Just suppose I called upon a gypsy to find you're gonna break my heart someday. So, darling, I'm confessing, not knowing is a blessing. You can keep me guessing, come what may.
Oh, she sings fine, really fine, Patti. Thank you. Now, folks, I'd like to welcome one of my very good friends, cohort and associate of some years back on the Kraft Music Hall, a man whose rural ruminations and homespun hokum are familiar to one and all. Van Buren, Arkansas's ambassador to the San Fernando Valley, Bob Byrne.
Well, thank you, Bing. Thank you. I'm awful glad you introduced me like I'm a member of the diplomatic corps. After all, I am known as the Anthony Eden of Canoga Park.
Yeah, I've seen that raccoon Homburg you wear.
Yeah, it's lucky I read Esquire. I knew enough to cut the tail off.
What'd you do with the raccoon tail, Bob? You got it hung on the radiator of your car?
No, I had it made into a choker for my peahen.
Man, that's stylish. That's real style. A fur choker for your peahen. I bet that caused quite a stir around the hen house.
It sure did. Plenty of gossip going on, too.
Yeah?
The other birds think she's been stepping out with a rich old bald eagle. Nothing personal.
No, nothing pointed. I believe you, Bob. Nothing like a gal in a new fur piece to start tongues wagging. Say, by the way, what does your peacock think of the peahen getting all dolled up like that?
Oh, Bing, he's burned up.
Good,
he packed up his plumes and moved to his club.
Well, I guess when you get right down to it, animals and birds, they will have their little squabbles, just as human beings will.
Yeah, you know, birds and animals own farms nowadays. They're just as used to mechanical conveniences as human beings
are. Oh, sure. Modern farms is the last word.
Well, I've got electric nest warmers for my hens.
Yeah?
Yeah, you know, in the cold winter, them hens used to lay their eggs from a standing position.
You need an egg catcher. That's what you need.
Yeah, I've got ultraviolet ray slop troughs for my hogs.
No, really?
You know, my cows have never been touched by human hands.
I don't believe
up till the big storm a couple of weeks ago, that is.
What happened then?
Well, the storm blew down the power lines and they couldn't use the milking machine.
Good heavens, that might have been catastrophic.
Well, yeah, you see, my cows had never been milked by anything but a machine.
Mm-hmm.
When I started to milk them by hand, I milked and the milk, and nothing happened.
Well, what was wrong?
Well, tell you the truth, I think them cows are just as embarrassed as I was.
You mean you provoked some bovine blushes, huh?
Yeah.
That might have been a shock to them, Bob. I suppose up till then they'd always regarded you as a perfect gentleman.
Well, I tell you, Bing, you know, farming's a lot of trouble.
Of course it is. Plenty of headaches.
During that big storm, my ducks just pretty near went crazy. They never saw so much water.
Oh, man, we really got it, didn't we?
I tell you, those ducks was hysterical. Had to take them to see a doctor.
Oh, did you take them to a psychiatrist?
No, I always take my ducks to a quack.
Well, this is an age of specialization.
Well, I've been trying to get my chickens to lay more eggs, So I put electric lights in the hen house so the hens wouldn't fall asleep on the job.
Oh, you keep the hen house lighted at night so the hens will produce more eggs, huh?
Yeah, not working out so good at my place, though.
Why not?
Well, every night my rooster sneaks in and turns off the lights.
I guess that's just a rooster that doesn't believe in progress.
I'm not so sure about that.
You're raising lots of chickens, huh, Bob?
Oh, the chickens are just a sideline, Bing. At heart, I'm a pig man.
Oh,
you know, I made a mistake when I got them pigs. I got all pedigreed hogs.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know. I'm sorry I did, because I get an inferiority complex. You know, I haven't got a hog on my place didn't come from a better family than I did.
Pretty fancy, huh?
Yeah. Why, the fancy hogs, I let them come right in the house with me.
Isn't that a little unsanitary?
They haven't caught anything yet.
Rugged beast. But, Bob, I know you didn't drop in to discuss pigs. There's something that you wanted to talk to me about. What do I owe the pleasure of this little visit? Hmm?
Well, Bing, tell you the truth, I'm always after something, ain't I? I came down here to see you because I got some problems. What advice can you give me about going on television?
Don't. Next problem, please.
Well, I really have got a problem trying to cook up a television show. You see, on radio, I had all my kinfolks to talk about.
Well, that's simple. Why don't you put your kinfolks on television?
Bing, I had trouble cleaning that bunch up for radio.
Can't be as bad as all that. You must have some relatives with talent.
Well, now that you mention it, some of them do. There's my Aunt Pudgy.
Aunt Pudgy?
Yeah, that's my fat aunt. She's quite a singer.
She ever appeared in public singing anyway?
Yeah, sure. Her ideal is Lily Pond.
Oh, yeah.
I remember she got a picture of Lily Pond's and had a dress made just like the one Lily Pond's had on.
Is that so?
And she gave a concert at King's Opera House in Van Buren. That's before they put the hay in there. And, you know, when she got that dress on, she didn't look a thing like Lily Pond's. Where Lily Pond's curves in, Aunt Pudgy curves out. Where Lily Pond's curves out, Aunt Pudgy leaves the road entirely.
Oh, disappear. That sounds dangerous. You should paint a white line down her back or something. But you got plenty of other relatives anyhow. What about your Uncle Slug?
Yeah, that's my drinking uncle.
How about him?
If I could sober him up, he might be good for one of them afternoon cooking shows.
Do you cook, Uncle Slug?
Well, not exactly, but he's got a wonderful recipe for making white mule in a hollow tree stump.
Sounds like quite a science. Does he lose many stumps?
Well, it's funny you mentioned losing them stumps. You know, he used to have a way. Don't look for it. It ain't on
I
there.
Don't think so. Very little of it is. I've got a skeleton.
You know, he used to mix his stuff in a hollow stump, and then he'd age it. And the way he found out if it was aged, ready to drink or not, he'd go there and he'd drop a horseshoe in it. If the horseshoe went to the bottom, wasn't ready yet.
Mm-hmm.
If the horseshoe curled up and jumped out, it's ready to drink. And you know, after he drained off that liquor, many a time I've seen that stump get up and go off through the woods looking for bear.
Sounds like a powerful potion Uncle Slug makes, but assuming that you could lure Uncle Slug away from his stump and get him on his feet, is there anything he could do, any entertainment he could provide on TV? What's his act?
Well, Uncle Slug, quite a performer. He plays a jug.
You mean he can get a tune out of a jug?
If there's anything in a jug, he'll get it out.
Well, gee, Bob, I'm sorry. All your relatives aren't shaping up for the TV show. At least none of those we've mentioned. We haven't dug up anybody yet.
Well, I got others.
Who?
My cousin Walford, my Aunt Peachy Sims, Uncle Hod Dernit.
Mm-hmm.
None of them can do anything.
Everything will come out all right, Robin. By God, I sure wish you'd brought your bazooka with you tonight so we could have done a number together.
I've got my bazooka here.
I had to open my big mouth.
You know, the bazooka is a mighty handy instrument, Bing. I pumped out my basement, you know.
During the flood?
Yeah. I'm going to have to play this tonight.
Well, is it broke?
Boy, I'll kill the next plumber that borrows this thing from me.
Say, Bob, what song do you think we ought to chop up for the folks tonight?
Let's do one of those oldies that we can kind of play a little sneaky.
Yeah.
You know that How Come You Do Me Like You Do?
I certainly do.
But let's go now. You folks in the front row there, watch it. Don't get too close to this horn. This is a flood area, you know. Okay, John.
How come you do me like you do, do? How come you do me like you do? Why do you always make me blue?
Mama, I ain't done nothing to you. You might be the meanest gal in town. I'm just mean enough to turn your damper down. How come you do me like you do, do, do? How come you do me like you do? How come you do me like you do?
Ball Fairy Line. You were never in better lip, Bob. Now, if I may, I would like to be excused for a minute and get on to a delightful chore here with Miss Patti Page. You ready, Patti?
Yes, what's on your mind, Bing?
Well, if you catch a little cold, I'll sneeze for you.
Well, I'm not expecting one, but it's a very attractive offer.
Well, I try to be gallant at all times. This is a sort of a semi-precious duet. Who starts it, Patti?
Well, what do you say let's jump off together?
You mean, well, you're taking a long chance, Cap.
If you catch a little cold, I'll sneeze for you. On a frosty winter day, I'll freeze for you. If you're restless, I will sail the seas for you to prove that I'm in love.
If an onion burns my eye,
I'm gonna weep for you.
If I'm spying on a friend,
I'll peep for you.
If I wanna jump for joy,
I'll leap for you to prove that I'm in love.
And if you're nervous, I will bite my lip. I'll be your stand-in where you stand.
And you won't have to move a fingertip. Automatically, your wish is my command.
If there's water in your boat, I'll bail for you. If you build a house, I'll hit the nail for you. If you break the law, I go to jail for you to prove that I'm in love.
I'd love to be beside you everywhere, to grant your wishes on the spot.
And if I spoiled you, do you think I'd care? I most certainly would not.
At a phony wrestling match, I'll boo for you. If you tumble down the stairs, I'll sue for you. I have hardly told you all I do for you, 'cause I'd do anything you ask me to do to prove that I'm in love.
Thank you, Patti. Ready? Go.
One, two, three, four. Get the smoke that gives you more. Five, six, seven, eight. Chesterfields are going great.
Thousands are changing every day. All over the country you hear them say, Chesterfield.
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 Milder, so much milder, milder Chesterfield.
That's right.
Seems everyone's changing in Arkansas. Well, the other day they even got Paul. He switched to the one that sets the pace with no unpleasant aftertaste.
The best cigarette for you, that's right.
So do what I always do, that's right.
Sound off for Chesterfield.
Sound off
for Chesterfield.
Try a pack of Chesterfields and do it
today.
Friends, it's true. All across the country, more and more smokers are changing to Chesterfield. How about you? Sound off for Chesterfield. For the first time, you'll get the cigarette that's much milder with the added protection of no unpleasant aftertaste.
Mm-hmm.
A very popular ballad of the fall and winter season. Everybody's had a go at it. I'd better do the same, or I'll get shut out here on the good ones.
Take away the breath of flowers, it would surely be a sin. Take the rain from April showers, and it's a sin. Take away the violins, dear, from a lovely symphony, and the music deep within would cease to be. Is it a sin to love you so, to hold you close and know you are leaving? Though you take away my heart, dear, still the beating there within, I'll keep loving you forever, for it's no sin. Is it a sin to love you so, to hold you close and know you are leaving? Though you take away my heart, dear, still the beating there within, keep loving you forever, for it's no sin.
Now, as this meeting comes to a close tonight, I would like to thank Patti Page and Bob Burns for joining up with us this evening.
I surely enjoyed it, Bing.
See you soon, Patti. Folks, you'll be with us, I hope, next week when our guest is going to be Mr. Fred Astaire.
Bing, ain't you getting a little optimistic there?
What do you mean, Bob?
You just announced Fred Astaire will be your guest next week. You sure radio's going to hold out that long?
I think maybe it'll hold together for a couple of three more weeks, Bob. Anyhow, that's got to get it for now. We'll rendezvous with you next Wednesday night. Meanwhile, what are you waiting for? Try a pack of Chesterfields and do it today. For the first time, you get the cigarette that's much milder with the added protection of no unpleasant aftertaste.
The Bing Crosby Show, presented by Chesterfield, was produced and transcribed in Hollywood by Bill Morrow and Murdo MacKenzie. Tune in next week and hear Bing and his guest, Mr. Fred Astaire. Friends, every victim of infantile paralysis in the last 5 years has received aid from National Foundation for Infantile Paralysis Funds. Last year, thousands of needy polio patients received direct financial aid. Thousands more who were able to pay their own bills were helped by the trained personnel, by the equipment, and by the research also provided by your National Foundation. The March of Dimes is truly everybody's. Give more dimes and dollars to your 1952 March of Dimes today.